So, yeah, finally, we have the last lecture. Your suffering will be ended. Oh yeah, so let me give you an announcement. So we still have the last homework. So last homework due next Tuesday. And we have, as I mentioned earlier, there will be an exam on Tuesday, next Tuesday, right here, from the usual class time, I think, it's like that, right? So the exam will be closed book, closed note, but I want you to focus on just understanding the materials. You don't have to remember formulas like via character formula. If you have to use these, they will be given in the exam, so you don't have to remember like complicated formula. Just try to focus on understanding the class materials and homework problems, okay? And hopefully it won't be that difficult once you understood what was going on here. All right, any question about the exam? Okay, then let's start this lecture. So we learned while character formula. What is that? When you have an irreducible representation and a character with highest weight, okay. So pi mu, v mu is irreducible representation, highest weight mu, then this can be computed like, actually this is the definition. Definition is like multiplicity of lambda, this, and this is in fact a trace of e to the lambda h, oh, it's not lambda h, pi of, as an operator, something like that. And this five character formula says that this can be computed like this. Sum of all while group elements, determinant e to the mu plus delta h. Right? And we, last time we proved while dimension formula using while character formula. I mean, we developed some kind of variation of L'Hopital's rule. And while character dimension formula says that dimension of the representation can be computed this way. Product over all alpha mu plus delta, alpha delta, like that. So let's try to use this for an example. So I just stated the example, but let's go over this in details. So we have SL3 and mu is m1 mu1, M2, mu2, where these coefficients are non-negative integers, and mu1, mu2, these are the fundamental weights. Then the dimension of the irreducible representation with highest weight mu is equal to 1 over 2, m1 plus 1, M2 plus 1, M1 plus M2 plus 2. So let's see how we can prove this. So let's write this again. While dimension formula says that this can be computed in this way. So that means all we need to do is to find this inner product, right? But what is R plus, the set of positive roots? It's going to be alpha 1, alpha 2, and we have one more, which is alpha 3. That is just sum of the two simple roots. And delta is half the sum of the positive root. And this, because this is equal to this, is the same thing as alpha 3. And actually, we have to remember what this is. So recall, if delta in general, alpha 1 dot 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 alpha r, if this is a base of a root system, then the fundamental weight mu 1, these are determined by this inner product. Fundamental weight by definition are given by this. Okay? And we know, so what is, let's draw the diagram of alpha. It looks like that, right? This is alpha 1, a 2 root system, 2, oh, what is that? This is alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, like that. So what is 2, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 1, alpha 1? We know that this is 1, right? But this means that, but this is kind of a review. This is a ratio of a projection of alpha 2 onto alpha 1. So if we project this onto alpha 1, this is half. Minus 1 over 2, so multiply 2, so it's minus 1. By the way, we may assume that because here we have a ratio of inner product, we can renormalize the inner product. Doesn't matter if you replace inner product by a constant, a fixed constant times another inner product, because it's a ratio. So we will assume, we may assume that for all I, so I 1, 2, 3, alpha I, alpha I. So this is the length of this root, but we can just renormalize it. So we may assume that, say, this is 2. Let's say the length of each root is 2. Doesn't matter. If your length is 1, it's okay, because we have just ratio over here. Then what does, then, since alpha 1, alpha 2, what is that then? This is 2, so it's going to be minus 1. So we can compute this thing over here. So what is alpha 1 delta? This is alpha 1 delta is alpha 3, right? Alpha 3 is alpha 1, alpha 2. Inner product alpha 1, this is 2. This inner product with this is minus 1, it's going to be 1, right? So we can just compute it like that. Alpha 2 delta is the same thing, is going to be 1. And alpha 3 delta, this is alpha 1 plus alpha 1. Oops, alpha 1 plus alpha 2. But if you compute this, it's just 2. Because this is just sum of these two. That means, okay, I think I need more space. Let me erase this part because we don't need this anymore. So let me write it over here. So now we computed this already. So the denominator is going to be 1 times 1 times 2. Okay. So what about the numerator? So alpha 1 mu plus delta. So alpha 1 inner product with mu, what is that? By the definition of by the definition of fundamental weight, this means, because now we assume that this is 2, mu I alpha j is just delta I j, right? So if you take the inner product with alpha 1 with mu, then we get m1, right? So m1, we already know that this is 1, right? This times this, this inner product with this is 1. And this, again, now we have m2. And what about alpha 3? We know that alpha 3 is alpha 1 plus alpha 2, so it's going to be the sum of this. M1, M2, plus 2. Okay? That's why we have the product of this over here, which is exactly as is stated. So that's the proof. We can evaluate the dimension this way. Now, I'm going to move on to the next section. This will be the final section in our lecture, the Kostka multiplicity. Kostka, no, it's not Kostka. I was confused with something else. It should be constant. Constant multiplicity formula. So, goal here. So, what did we do last time? We used Weyl character formula to find the dimension of an irreducible representation. But now we have an irreducible representation. For given integral element lambda, what is the weight multiplicity of that? We want to know that. So, find the formula for the multiplicity of a weight lambda in this irreducible representation using Weyl character formula. So recall, we know that this character by definition is lambda multiplicity of, okay, this is the multiplicity of lambda in mu. So if you know the character, if you know how to expand this in this form, then you can compute the multiplicity by looking at the coefficient of this exponential function. And Weyl character formula says that this is equal to summation. I already wrote this, but let's do this again. So, this is not quite in this form. They are different. But we know, we denoted this by Qt, right? Q of H, Weyl denominator, right? So we have this Weyl denominator. If we can somehow expand, so this is 1 over something. If we can somehow expand this as a series like this, then we can multiply them together to obtain a series expression for this. And once we have done that, we can just look at the coefficient and then we can read off this multiplicity. That's what we are going to do. So if we can expand 1 over Q of H as a series like this, something like this, lambda, C lambda, E, and then we multiply this together with this, then we get a formula like that. Then we will get a formula for this multiplicity. That's the idea. To illustrate this idea, let's see an example with this SL2 case, which can be which is quite simple, but it really tells us the underlying idea. So we have this irreducible representation of SL2C with highest weight mu, which is just m, one-dimensional case. And while character formula we already know, we already computed this, so every element in the Cartan subalgebra is just h, the usual basis h times a, and we already computed that this is given like that. We did this without using Weyl character formula, but of course we can use Weyl character formula to get this immediately. So the Weyl denominator is e to the a minus e to the minus a. So 1 over e to the a, how can we expand this as a series like before? We know how to expand a geometric series. So let's rewrite this like a geometric series. Vector e to the a, then 1 minus e to the minus 2a, right? This is the same. So just keep this as a constant, and then let's try to expand this as a geometric series. So it's e to the minus a for this vector. It doesn't do anything. So 1 plus e to the minus 2a plus e to the minus 4a plus dot dot dot. It's an infinite series like that. So that means if you use this expansion, x pi a h equals, we have the numerator, and then let's replace this denominator by this. So times e to the minus a, I think we can just let's combine them together. So e to the minus a plus e to the minus 3a, e to the minus 5a, dot dot dot, right? Now, if you multiply them together, what do we get? So first, we multiply this to all of the factors there. Then we get e to the ma, and then the exponent is decreased by 2 at a time, which is an infinite series. And minus, we have to have this part. This times this, it's going to be e to the m minus m plus 2a, and then it decreases by 2 again, like that. I'm sorry, it's all plus. And because we have two infinite series, you can see actually this also appears here. It's, this also appears e to the minus ma, and then e to the minus m plus 2a A plus dot dot dot, right? Then you can, as you can see, these all cancel each other. So we are left with just this thing. All the way up to e to the minus ma. Shall we write in this form? This is really mah. Right? M minus 2. I'm just trying to write this in the usual form so that we can really compare with that. That means the coefficient here is 1. That means M, it is a weight, and its weight multiplicity is 1. And M minus 2 is a weight, whose weight multiplicity is also 1. So everything here that appears in this exponent, they have weight multiplicity 1. And other integral elements, they do not appear. So conclusion, we can conclude that multiplicity m minus 2, that all of them are 1 in this irreducible representation Vm, as we already saw before. In this calculation, you may wonder what happens if this is not a convergent power series, right? If it's not a convergent power series, for instance, if this exponent, if the this part, if this part is greater than 1, if the absolute value of this is greater than 1, then this diverges. So this doesn't make sense. But it does make sense as a formal power series. And the fact is, you can find alpha, or A, so that this is really a convergent power series, right? If alpha is, if alpha is like A is greater than 1, say, then this is less than 1. So it really a convergent power series. And for small interval, if you can find a small interval for alpha so that this is a convergent power series, then this makes sense. And they are exactly the same as a formal power series as well. So I'm not going to go into the details, but this is a known fact in analysis. If you can find a small interval for which alpha works, then they are identically the same formal power series. So everything that we are going to do today, even though we are doing formally, it works perfectly well, and then at the end we will get the correct result. But the idea behind it is the fact that we borrowed from analysis like that. Okay, so this is the basic idea, and we want to do the same thing for the general situation. All right. So let's define this formal exponential series. It's like a formal power series with exponential. Formal exponential series is just this. For lambda, integral element, something like that. So here, lambda, sum over all integral element. And each C lambda for given lambda is going to be a complex number. So this is not considered as a function just yet. So if you have H, you get some kind of series like that. But it may not converge. So we just treat this as a formal. So it's kind of like a, you can think of this as a function from integral element to complex numbers like that. So far it's just formal. But if all, the summation could be infinite, but if the summation is finite, meaning that all but finite C lambda are zero, then it is called a finite exponential series. Finite exponential series. So if it's finite, it does make sense as a function always. And if we have two formal exponential series, D, they have different coefficient, of course. If this and G finite form exponential series, then we can define their product, FG. FG is well defined, and this is product over all, of course, it's another formal power series, a formal exponential series. Let's not use E and say B. You can multiply them. And what is D? What is this B coefficient? This is sum over all, say, mu and nu, whose sum equals lambda, and this C mu D nu. Okay? It's like we usually, this is the usual way we multiply two summation, right? You select one term from here, you select one term there, and then you just multiply them like that, term by term. But we have to assume that one of them is finite, because if both of them are infinite, this is an infinite sum. This is always a finite sum. Because after all, this is, in other words, sum over all nu, sum over all nu, okay, just to make it crystal clear, let's write nu over here, nu, nu. So this is finite sum, this is finite. It's only finite nu except finite nu, this will be zero. So for all this finite, basically you sum over all this. Once you fix nu, what is mu? Mu must be lambda minus nu, d nu. This is the same thing, so it's the same thing. It's a finite sum, so it's a well-defined multiplication. If one of them is finite, we can multiply them. This is good because in the Weyl character formula, the numerator is a finite sum. It's a sum over all w in the Weyl group, which is finite. And definition, all right, let's use the definition next page because that's the critical definition today. So, definition, lambda is an integral element, and p of lambda is defined to be equal to the number of ways to express lambda as a non-negative integer combination, integer linear combination of positive roots. In other words, it's the number of ways to, number of these tuples, tuples of integers such that lambda summation r plus c lambda alpha, where each coefficient is non-negative integer. So it's the same thing. And this p, this function, this is called the constant partition function. So once you have, so it's a function from the integral elements to real or complex number, or as integers. Because the because this is a number, it's going to be always non-negative integer. So, what I mean is like an integral element to non-negative integers, function like that, called a constant partition function. Actually, another way of put this is that this is, notice that it's the same thing as this. The number of ways to go from the origin to lambda by using steps, positive roots. But of here we have to ignore the order of the steps. I'm going to explain this in with an example, because this means if you have like a 2 alpha, that means you start from 0. So suppose the lambda is 2 alpha 1 plus 3 alpha 2, for instance. That means you can go from, if this is alpha 1, this is alpha 2, then that means you go 1 twice in this direction, and then 1, 2, 3. So that means lambda is over there. But what I mean by ignoring the order of the step means that, of course, you can use, by using the same number of steps, you can go this way, but they all consider to be the same thing. We don't consider their order. We just focus on how many times each positive root is used. So, okay, let's see an example. G is SL3, C, delta is the base, simple root, and R plus, we know alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, which is alpha 1 plus alpha 2. Then let's let alpha be m1 alpha 1 plus m2 alpha 2, where these coefficients are non-negative integers. Then p, what is the constant partition function of alpha, lambda? And the claim is this is 1 plus the minimum of m1, m2. Okay, let's prove this. By definition, p lambda is the number of this triple C1, C2, C3 such that lambda is equal to C1 alpha 1, C2 alpha 2, C3 alpha 3. So this is the number of ways to write lambda as a non-negative integer linear combination of the positive roots. So let's, but we know that this is M1 alpha 1 plus M2 alpha 2, and then we know that this is C3 alpha 1 plus alpha 2. So let's rewrite this, and then we get, by combining alpha 1, then it's like this, right? And because alpha 1, alpha 2, they form a basis, we must have this equality. These two must be the same, and these two must be the same. So M1 is equal to C1 plus C3, M2 is equal to C2 plus C3, but because C1, C2, they are non-negative integers, C3 must be less than or equal to M1, and also less than or equal to M2. If this is bigger than one of these, then C1, C2, you cannot find them in the non-negative integers, right? But once C3 satisfies this, then you can always find C1, C2, because C1 is just M1 minus C3, C2 is M2 minus C3. Once you fix C3 in this range, you get a unique solution with given C3. That means, so this basically means C3 is less than M minimum of them, and there are these plus one possibilities for the choice of C3, and that's basically the all possibilities for this triple, because once you fix C3, C1, C2 are automatically determined. And that's the proof. And I'm going to give you an example of this, of the diagram. So here is an example of Kostkov partition function for A2, to be our favorite diagram like that. So each dot represents integral weight, integral element whose Kostkov partition function is non-zero. So this one, what is the Kostkov partition function of this element, zero? Is 1, because 1 is 1, 0 plus alpha 1, 0 plus alpha 2, 0 plus alpha 3. So this is 2 because Kostkov partition function, I told you, another way to compute that is to compute, to count how many times can you go, how many ways are there to go from the origin to this by using only alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3. But once you decide the number of times alpha 3 is used, then that is determined. So from here to here, how many times can you use alpha 3? In this direction, you can only use once at most, right? So you can use at most once, that means you can use either 0 or 1, so this is 2. Because once you fixed, okay, I'm going to use alpha 3 once, then you go once like that, and then you don't have any choice but going in this direction using alpha 2. So it's gonna, they all, these all have 2. because these for those in this line, two lines, you can only use alpha 3 once at most. What about this? You can use alpha 3 twice at most. So once or twice. You can use it zero times, then how can you go there? Can you go there without using alpha 3? Yes, alpha 2. Now we are stuck. But of course now we can go up like this and this, and then you can go back with alpha 1 like that. Okay? For here, alpha 2, alpha 2, alpha 1, alpha 1. Like that. So that's why these numbers are written like that. So you can compute constant partition function of each dot like that. So dots, except those, they all have constant partition function 0. Because you cannot go there without using only alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3. Okay? Right. So this will be, constant partition function will be used in our formula. So first, we have to invert the while denominator, because we want to write that as a series so that we can multiply with the numerator. And here, this proposition tells us how to do that. Sum over all, this is integral element, dominant integral element, greater than or equal to zero. Integral element greater than zero. And constant partition function evaluated that, and e to the minus, yes, as a formal exponential series. What does that mean, formal exponential series? That means formally means, what does inverse mean? Inverse is something that gives you 1 if you multiply by that number. So it means 1 is QH times this thing. That's what the inverse means usually, right? Because we can multiply them. This is a finite sum. It's sum over all roots. Or while group elements. All right, so proof. We will be using this lemma, whose proof I'm going to omit, lemma 28, that says that the while denominator has a different expression, alpha r plus. And if you remember, this is one of the homework problems, but only for AN case, right? SLN. For SLN case, you prove this as a homework problem, right? And in fact, it's true for general. The proof is clearly written in the textbook, so I'm going to omit the proof. So we know this is product of this factor, and this is somehow familiar to us because we did it for SL2 case. So how can we find the inverse of this? We can express this as a geometric series by first factoring out this thing. 1 minus, now e to the minus alpha h, right? Now we can expand this denominator. So that means this is going to be e to the minus alpha h over 2, 1 plus e to the minus alpha h plus e to the minus 2 alpha h, dot, dot, dot. So for each factor here, you can one of it, so if you do this 1 over, it's the same thing. For each factor, we can expand it like this. So it's going to be product of this for all positive roots alpha, right? That means QH inverse is product of this. But what is the product of this for all positive roots alpha? So if you have a product in the exponent, they add up. So it's sum over all alpha, half of the alpha. That is delta, right? So it's going to be minus e to the minus delta h for the product of this. And now you have just the product of these things. That. Now all you need to do is just to expand this as usual. Okay, let's just look at this part. This is sum over all eta greater than or equal to 0. Greater than or equal to 0 means integral element, which can be written as a positive or non-negative integer linear combination of positive roots. So although we have infinite exponential series, we can, in this case, we can multiply them, because for each given given integral element, the coefficient is coefficient is finite sum. So in order to obtain this, how can you obtain that? By selecting this, and then they add up together to obtain this. And this, the coefficient here will be the constant partition function, because this is the number of ways to write eta as a sum like this. Exactly the definition of the constant partition function. Because the way you multiply them is exactly the same thing as this kind of operation. And that's the proof. We obtained this formula then, this thing over here. Okay, so finally I can state the formula. It's a theorem, endpoint 29. This is a constant multiplicity formula. So again, we have this irreducible representation of a semisimple Lie algebra G with highest weight mu. Then the multiplicity of an integral element lambda is summation over sum over all variable elements, determinant of WP of W mu plus delta minus lambda plus delta. So it's a sum like that. So a finite sum. So in finite time, in theory, you can evaluate this. Proof. By definition, we know that this is like that, multiplicity. So all we need to do is to expand this as a series, a formal exponential series. And by file character formula and the proposition we just proved, which is about the expansion of the vial denominator, we now can write this So this is the while numerator of the while character formula. It looks like this. So we have to multiply the inverse of while denominator, but in the previous proposition, we show that the inverse of the while denominator looks like this. Right? So now the first sum is finite, so you can multiply them. So, but by the way, let's just write them together like that. Let's multiply them. So determinant W P these coefficients, and then we can add the the exponent, and this is gonna be W mu plus delta minus eta plus delta H, right? So we want to express in this way. We want to say that we want to collect so that this is lambda. Well, given lambda, we want to collect W and eta so that it's lambda, right? So that means, let's just say this is lambda, then sum over all lambda, and sum over all W. So what does that mean? So let's write this over here. So W dot mu plus delta minus eta plus delta equals lambda, that means what? That means actually it's the same thing as eta is eta is W mu plus delta minus lambda plus delta, right? You just replace their position, right? So once lambda is fixed, eta must be this. So its sum is only for the lambda, eta sum is changed to a lambda sum. So this determinant of mu, but what is eta? Eta is this. But now this is just e to the lambda h. Okay? But now, as you can see, this is the coefficient of this part, and this is the coefficient of this part, so they must agree. Because we show that this function is, they form a basis element of the space of the function from Cartan subalgebra to complex numbers. So if we have expressions like that, they must agree term by term. So that's the proof. They are equal. That's the end of the proof. Okay, notice that so this is the constant partition function, constant multiplicity formula. So basically, we need to evaluate this thing. So let's see what that is. P W mu plus delta minus, for given delta alpha, we want to know what this is. But this, by definition, is number of ways to write minus equals summation alpha r plus c alpha alpha, right? That's the definition. The coefficient must be non-negative integers. Or this is the same thing as, what is that? That's the same thing as, let's move alpha, lambda to the other side. Minus delta equals lambda plus summation c alpha alpha, the same sum. That means this is really the same. So what does this mean? This is a fixed vector, right? This is a fixed vector once we select lambda. So we want to go from lambda to this by using these steps. So this is really the number of ways to go from now, not from the origin, but from lambda to omega w mu plus delta minus delta using what? Positive roots, ignoring the SPC4, ignoring the order of the step. So it's like we just change the starting point. Okay? I'm going to show you an example. So, the example. It's like this. So, so we still have SL3. So we have alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3. So we consider the irreducible representation with weight mu given by 9,2. So we have a highest weight over here, but we want to know what are the weights and what are the weight multiplicities. But we already know that the weight the possible weights must be those inside the convex hull of the vial orbit of the vial group action on mu. So the vial, if you apply vial group action, this goes to this, and then this, and this, and this, and this, and so we get this kind of hexagon. So the weight will be the integral element inside this hexagon that can be obtained from the highest weight by going back and forth using only the roots, right? So this is a weight, but this part in the middle is not a weight because you cannot go there by using these kind of steps. So we know that these dots, actually we have to fill the whole stuff using black dots like that. But we know, because now we want to know the multiplicities, but multiplicities are invariant under the vial group action. That means if you know the multiplicities of those in this fundamental vial chamber, then you know what are the vial multiplicities are, because here they are just the same thing as there. You just reflect it over this hyperplane, then you get the multiplicities over there and there, there, and etc. So all we need to do is to find the multiplicities of those dots. And let's see how we can get them. So for instance, let's look at this pink dot. This is a weight. And what is the weight multiplicity? So the thing is, the multiplicity of lambda, the constant multiplicity formula says like that. But this part, what is the meaning of this? I just mentioned briefly earlier that this is the number of ways to go from this minus delta, number of ways to go to this minus delta, from lambda to this minus delta, right? So if this vial group element is the identity, we have this, so this minus delta is right there, just mu, right? We have mu, so let's look at this pink dot. How many ways can we go from this dot to this using alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3? Without considering their order. It's a 3, because it only is just determined by the number of ways you use alpha 3. And you can use alpha 3 how many times? Up to 2 times, because you can go alpha 1, alpha 3, alpha 3 like that. 2 is the maximum. So you can use alpha 3 either 0, 1, or 2 times. So that there are 3 ways to go from here to there using these steps. That's why it's written 3 like that. Okay, we only consider only one term here, because if lamb omega, if this W is not identity, for instance, if W is somewhere here, you cannot go from, so this is W dot mu plus delta, but we take the, we subtract it by delta, we get over here. You cannot go from here to there by using these three steps. So it's zero. So for every other viral group element, it's going to be zero. That's why we only have one term left, and that is three. And that's why it's written three there. Okay? On the other hand, let's look at this green dot. Similarly, okay, over here. Again, the multiplicity formula says that this equals summation like that. But now we have two possible viral group elements. If the viral group element is identity, we can go from here to there by using only these three steps, so that survives over here. And also, if you reflect about this hyperplane, which is S alpha 2, then we get this. This is W dot mu plus delta. We subtract by delta, so we get over here. We can go from here to here there by using only these three steps. So this term also survives, but everything else stays there, just zero. So we have two terms in this formula. As before, we can compute this. What is this? Number of ways to go from here to there by using only three steps. How many ways can we do that? We can use alpha 3 either 0, 1, 2, 3. So there are four possibilities. So it's going to be 4. What about this? So we subtract delta there. So we want to go from this point to this point. But there is only one way. We can only use alpha 1. This is the only possibility. So we subtract 1. So the final answer will be 3. So the weight multiplicity of this is 3. In this way, you can compute all the weight multiplicities. Okay? So constant multiplicity formula is quite a nice formula because it allows us to compute weight multiplicities like that quite easily, which was not so easy before we had this tool. But still, evaluating the constant partition function is not a simple problem. For A2 is easy, but even for AN, evaluating the constant partition function for a given weight is not so easy. It can be a challenging problem. And it has many connections with combinatorics and some polytope theory. So, for instance, a volume of some polytope called a flow polytope, its volume can be interpreted in terms of constant partition function. But of course, because the evaluation of the constant partition function is not so easy, even though we have this formula, finding the weight multiplicity in general can be a very challenging problem. So this is still a quite an active research topic in representation, combinatorial representation theory. So I think I said all I wanted to say. So this is the end of the lecture. And I think Lie algebra, it has many connections with different areas in mathematics. So even though you are not really doing research in this direction, in your own research area, you may see something related to Lie algebras or viral groups, root systems, or type A, B, C, etc. So I hope that you can get some benefit from what you learned in this semester. So I will finish this lecture and thank you very much for your attention. Yeah. So yeah, that's it. Thank you. And like I mentioned, there will be an exam next week.